Just as it was in Noah's time before the sudden coming of the flood. People wouldn't believe what was going to happen until the flood actually arrived and took them all away. So shall my coming be. Two men will be working together in the fields, and one will be taken, the other left. Two women will be going about their household tasks. One will be taken, the other left. So be prepared, for you don't know what day your Lord is coming.
Life was filled with guns and war, and everyone got trampled on the floor. I wish we'd all been ready. Children died, the days grew cold, a piece of bread could buy a bag of gold. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come, you've been left behind. A man and wife are sleeping there. She hears a noise and turns her head. He's gone. I wish we'd standing still. I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come.
Goddess of fertility, the principal female goddess, celestial body of the Phoenicians, worshipped in war and fertility, the goddess of love and increase, right? And she's the consort of Baal. She's the consort of Baal. So we've got this thing going on with Baal, who's Jupiter, and with Venus, who's Ashtaroth, the goddess of fertility. We've just got this, the goddess of love and fortune, right? We've just got this relationship going on. Now, this is what I think Jeremiah 32, 35 might actually mean, because they've got Ashtaroth. They're worshipping Ashtaroth, and she's given them the fertility to make their giants, and that's the idea. That's why they're doing this, because they want to make giants. They want to make giants such as what are ruling the world today. And they built the high place to Baal. They did that because they want to make giants after they'd been worshipping the goddess of fertility. So the goddess of fertility, Ashtaroth, had given them the abilities to do these things because they're worshipping these celestial bodies and not the Lord. And they built the high places of Baal, Jupiter, right? Which are in the valley of the son of Hinnom. That's where they make giants to cause, right? Their sons and daughters to pass through the fire of Molech. So Molech is Saturn, and we've got Baal is Jupiter, and Baal is having a relationship with Ashtaroth, Venus. So they build the high places to Baal to cause, so they can make their sons and daughters pass through the fire to Molech, to Saturn, because when they do that, they make giants. It seems to be that when they worship Baal and Ashtaroth, who are having a relationship, when they do that, they pass their sons and daughters through the fire to Molech, and that's where a giant's formed. That's where a giant's formed. That's absolutely where I'm being led to think right now with all of this. How it actually manifests in the physical, I don't know, but that's what these scriptures are leading me to think right now. We've got Venus and Jupiter having some sort of relationship, and when they're worshipped, that causes that seed, God's seed, to go through to Saturn, and then Saturn gives us giants, because Saturn is the god of the giants. The blue star is the star of Saturn. It's the star of the giants. It's the star of the god of the giants, the star of Remphan, the star of the giants. And that's who they
in First Kings 3, the Lord appears to Solomon and appears to give him the keys to the kingdom.
That's what
Solomon
made affinity with Pharaoh, king. And that's what it looks like is going on today.
And took Pharaoh's daughter and brought her into the city of David, that being the city of Zion. Is this a strange woman, and was this a sin? Until he had made an end of building his own house and the house of the Lord. Was that a sin? Was that a sin? Because in Acts 7, it tells us, but Solomon built him a house. And at some point, Solomon went from being 100% with the Lord to serving Lucifer. And the wall of Jerusalem round about the wall, right? The wall that's protecting it. The wall that has no breaches. Only the people sacrificed in high places. I'd love to know what that means. Only the people sacrificed in high places because there was no house built unto the name of the Lord in those days. And Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of David, his father. Only he sacrificed and burnt incense in high places. So I find this interesting because it says in verse 2 that only the people sacrificed in high places. But in verse 3, it tells us that only Solomon sacrificed and burnt incense in the high places. So I'm not quite sure what that means. And I also wonder whether this Solomon loved the Lord, walking in the statutes of David, his father. Walking in the statutes of David, his father. It's like David, I don't know, the law belongs to David. There's all these similarities with David and the Lord Jesus Christ. But I just wonder whether this is an indication that this isn't a sin. By making affinity with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and it also means that Solomon's wife, Pharaoh's daughter, isn't a strange woman. Because Solomon loved the Lord and he was walking in the statutes of David, his father. So at this point, Solomon's still with the Lord and he hasn't turned yet. And the king went to Gibeon to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. And 1,000 burnt offerings did Solomon offer upon that altar. Now, this place, Gibeon, is as just about as a fascinating place as it gets in the scriptures. Now, Gibeon means hill city, and it's a Levitical city of Benjamin, right? Benjamin, modern Egypt, which lies 5 miles or 8 kilometers from Jerusalem. And now, it's a Levitical city in the city of Benjamin. So that's leading me to think, because the Levites didn't get an inheritance. Their inheritance was the Lord, but they dwelt among the children of Israel. So that's leading me to think that this is where the Levites dwell, in the inheritance of Benjamin. And Benjamin, right? Benjamin again. And remember, one of Benjamin's sons was Rapha, and Rapha means giant, living in Hades. So Gibeon is a city of Benjamin. A place in Palestine, Gibeon, pertaining to a hill, a great town of the Hivites. So that's telling me that Gibeon is of the Hivites. And just this pertaining to a hill, built on a hill, hill city. I just wonder whether that's somehow connected to the high places. Because in 1 Kings 3, that's where Solomon went. Solomon went to Gibeon to sacrifice, for that was the great high place, Gibeon, right? And Gibeon means hill city. Does that mean a high place? It was a Levitical city of Benjamin, but before the children of Israel took it in Joshua, it was a great town. It was a great town of the Hivites. Now, Hivite means villages. The 6 generations of the descendants of Canaan, the son of Ham, who were living in northern Canaan, near Mount Hermon at the time of the conquest. So here we go with this Mount Hermon again. It's not the first time I've run into this of recent, Mount Hermon. Now in Genesis 10, we read about the Hivites. So we've got Canaan beget Zidon, right? So Zidon is the firstborn of Canaan, and Ethbaal is the king of Zidon. And when we read about the definition for Jezebel in Blue Letter Bible, Jezebel's giving us the daughter of the king of Tyre being Ethbaal, right? So we've got Canaan, his firstborn is Zidon. And this is one of the gods that Solomon whored after in 1 Kings 11, Zidon, right? And his firstborn, Heth. And then we've got the Jebusite and the Amorite and the Girgashite, the Hivite, the Argite and the Sinite. And on we go with the lineage and the Canaanites spread abroad. So we've got the Hivite. The Hivite is one of the sons of Canaan. Now, the first time we see outside of the lineage the word Hivite appear in the scriptures is in Genesis 34:2. Where Shechem, who was the son of Hamor, the Hivite, right? Now, this Shechem, he went in. He went in to Dinah and he defiled himself with her. And Dinah was the sister of the 12 brothers and he was the daughter of Jacob. And we've got Shechem, who's the son of a Hivite. So I'm being led to think that Shechem is a Hivite as well. These Hivites, meaning villagers, the descendants of Canaan, and this is where Gibeon is. Gibeon is in this place of the Hivites. And we see it in Genesis 36:2, where Esau took daughters of the Hivites to be his wife, right? But we read about the Hivites quite a lot, about being one of the seven nations that the Lord's going to cast out before the children of Israel, right? The Hivites. So Hivites, it means villagers, and they're a descendant of Canaan. And we've got Gibeon means hill city, pertaining to a hill, and it is a great town of the Hivites. So Gibeon seems to be a part of the Hivites, this hill city pertaining to a hill, and this is where Solomon went to sacrifice. He went to sacrifice in this high place at Gibeon. Now we first read the word Gibeon in Joshua 9. Now this is quite fascinating what happens here. Now Joshua 9, we read about the league, the covenant that's made between the children of Israel and the inhabitants of Gibeon. Now the inhabitants of Gibeon had heard what Joshua had done to Jericho and Ai. Now this word Ai, this is among other scriptures, is leading me to think that we're looking at celestial scriptures here, Gibeon included. Just some scriptures I'm going to share in just a bit that I have shared previously. Just this place, Ai. Now, the children of Israel, they had to smote Ai. They had to go to war with Ai twice because of the accursed thing. But the inhabitants of Gibeon heard what Joshua and the children of Israel had done to Jericho and Ai. Now, they lie. They want to make a league with the children of Israel, but for me, it looks as though they've lied here. They did work wilily and went and made as if, right, they had been ambassadors. So that, for me, I'm being led to think that this is their pretending. They're pretending like they're ambassadors. They're lying. But they went to Joshua unto the camp at Gilgal and said unto him and to the men of Israel, we become from a far country. Now therefore make ye a league with us. And they said to Joshua, we are thy servants. And Joshua said unto them, who are you? And whence come ye? So he's asking them where they've come from. And they told him, from a very far country thy servants are come because of the name of the Lord thy God, for we have heard the fame of him and all that he did in Egypt. Right? So this is Gibeon. This is where Solomon built the sacrifice, the place of sacrifice, and this is where the Lord appeared to Solomon, right? This Gibeon. And they've come from a very far country and they've heard the fame of the Lord of him and all that they did in Egypt. Now, it seems to me
that they have feared the Lord. They've feared the Lord, and they don't want to go to war with the five kings of the Canaanites that we read in Joshua 10. And instead, they've made a league. They want to make a league with the children of Israel because they're fearing the Lord God. Now, in verse 10 is just a knockout. And all that he did unto the two kings of the Amorites that were beyond Jordan, to Sihon, king of Heshbon, Amorites, he's the king of the Amorites, who's Sihon, and to Og, king of Bashan, right? King of Bashan, which was at Ashtaroth, right? So here we go. So this is the goddess of fertility. This is Venus. This is Venus. And we've got Og, who's the king of Bashan. He was dwelling seemingly at Venus, at the goddess of fertility. That's where Bashan was, right? So Sihon means warrior, and he was the king of the Amorites at the time of the conquest and defeated by Moses in Transjordan, sweeping away a leader carrying everything before him, a king of the Amorites reigning in Heshbon. Heshbon means stronghold, a capital city of Sihon, king of the Amorites, located on the western border of the high plain, right? Of the high plain, and on the borderline between the tribes of Reuben and Gad. So Heshbon is, it means stronghold, right? I read this term right through the scriptures that the cities were strongholds. It's the capital city of Sihon, and Sihon is the king of the Amorites, and Sihon means warrior. So Sihon means warrior, he's the king of the Amorites, and Heshbon means stronghold, which is the capital city of Sihon, right? Now check this out. Og means long necked. So straight away, we sort of know what this means, don't we? Og means long neck. Now, Og is the Amorite king of Bashan. So they're both Amorite kings. We've got Og, which means long-necked. He's an Amorite king of Bashan. And we've got Sihon. He's the king of the Amorites at the time of the conquest, and it means warrior. And he was the king over Heshbon, which means stronghold. But Og, which means long-necked, he was the Amorite king of Bashan and one of the last representatives of giants of Rephaim, right? So we've got the Valley of the Son of Hinnom that separates Mount Zion from the plain of Rephaim, and we've got Og, he means long neck. So this is a giant. Og's a giant, and he's the Amorite king of Bashan and one of the last representatives of the giants of Rephaim. So a question I've been asking for quite some time now is, all the Canaanites that were in Canaan, were they all giants? Because now I'm just at fever pitch that this could be true. Because we've got Og, he is one of the last representatives of the giants of Rephaim. And we've got Sihon, he's also a king of the Amorites. And in Joshua 9, we're hearing the men of Gibeon talking to Joshua about what they'd heard the Lord had done and how he seemingly has slain the remnant of the giants, Og, king of Bashan. And we're also hearing about Sihon, who's king of Heshbon, which is also Amorite. So they're both Amorite kings. So does that mean the whole of the Amorites now were potentially giants? And if all of the Amorites were giants, does that mean potentially that all of the Canaanites were giants? Because remember in Leviticus 18, they did everything. All the men of the land had done every single one of those commandments. They'd broken every single one of those commandments, and the land was defiled, and the land spewed them out. And one of those sins that they committed was laying carnally with your neighbor's wife. And by doing that, they're letting their seed pass through the fire to Molech, and they're making giants. And that's who these are. That's who these are. We've got Og, king of Bashan. And Bashan, it means long neck, and he's one of the last representatives of the giants at Rephaim, so there's more of them. And we read in Deuteronomy 3:11, for only Og, king of Bashan, remained of the remnant of the giants.
Right, and we read it a couple of times. And the rest of Gilead and all Bashan, being the kingdom of Og, gave I unto half the tribe of Manasseh and all the region of Argob with all Bashan, which is called the land of giants. So it just seems to me here that we've got Og, who's the king of Bashan. He is the remnant of the giants. So just that word remnant means that there was more. Because the children of Israel had a remnant at the end as well, and it seems that they were making giants. So how many giants were dwelling in the land of Canaan when Israel were there at the end before they were kicked out? And it just makes me think today, like how many giants are walking the earth today? And in the Chaldee lexicon for Og, king of Bashan, it's about his size, seemingly, in stature, long-necked, gigantic, of a king of Bashan, celebrated for his great size. So I don't know whether that means that it's about his physical size, but that's the first time in the scriptures where I've seen giants connected potentially to their physical size, or is this a spiritual size? Because you look at the people running the world today, and they are certainly gigantic, aren't they? And they're of a great size, and that word taller in Deuteronomy 1:28 does pertain to them being exalted. So is this pertaining to their physical side, or just about their stature, like these creatures that are running the earth today? But we've got Bashan. Their king is named Og, and he means long neck, the Amorite king of Bashan. Now, Bashan means fruitful, and I find this absolutely fascinating, because check this out. A district east of the Jordan known for its what? Known for its fertility, right? So Bashan means fruitful, and it's known for its fertility, and it was given to the half-tribe of Manasseh. Sandy soil, often with Bashan, the northern part of the region beyond Babylon, bounded on the north by the mountains of Here we go with this Hermon again, right? Here we go with this Hermon again. It just seems to be everywhere, this Mount Hermon and Hermon, when we're talking about giants. But Bashan means fruitful, and it's a district east of the Jordan known for its fertility. Now, Ephraim means I shall be doubly fruitful, and Ephraim, he is the brother of Manasseh. And we've got Bashan means fruitful, Ephraim means I shall be doubly fruitful, and Bashan is a region known for its fertility, and it was given to Ephraim's brother, Ephraim meaning I shall be doubly fruitful. But check this out again in Joshua 9, because we've got Og, king of Bashan, fruitful, an area known for its fertility. It was at Ashtaroth. It was at Ashtaroth, and Ashtaroth means star, and Ashtaroth is the goddess of fertility, Venus, where they're making giants. So we've got Og, who's the king of a region that means fruitful, that's known for its fertility, and it was given to Manasseh. And Manasseh's the brother of Ephraim, which means I shall be doubly fruitful. And we've got Og, who means long-necked, and who is a giant, the king of Bashan. Well, he is the king. He's the king of this region, known for its fertility, and that place is where the fertility goddess is. And a scripture to note with this word Bashan is Deuteronomy 33:32. And Dan, he said, so this is Moses giving the blessing to all the 12 tribes. And Dan, he said, Dan is a lion's whelp. He shall leap from Bashan. And we've got Bashan, it means fruitful, and it's a district east of the Jordan known for its fertility. And in Joshua 9, we read that place, Bashan, which means fruitful and was known for its fertile land, had a king who was a giant, and that place was situated at the goddess of fertility, Venus. Venus, right? And in Genesis 49, Jacob is given the blessings to all the 12 brothers, and Dan shall be a serpent, by the way. So Jacob is describing Dan as a serpent, and we've got Moses saying that Dan will leap as a lion's whelp from Bashan, and Bashan means fruitful, and it's an area known for its fertility. And Bashan's king was a giant, and that place, Bashan, which is known for its fertility, was situated at Ashtaroth, which is the goddess of fertility, Venus. So we've got the tribe of Dan being associated with the serpent and with Bashan, which is where giants dwell. And there's a lot of school of thought out there that Denmark today, the modern day Denmark, are the tribe of Dan. Now, I've done a video on this, and it's one of the few videos in my time doing videos on YouTube that was actually taken down. So why is it taken down? It's because they took it down for hate speech. And what's hate speech? Hate speech is when you speak the truth. And you look at the people of Denmark today, they're not like us. That Queen of Denmark, whatever that thing is, it's not like us. Is it a man? It's certainly not a woman. Is it a man? Or is it something that's not like us? You look at all the famous people of Denmark, and there's something about them. We've got connections to Denmark with the monarch butterfly. We've got connections with Denmark with Trump and the 88 and the time travel. And Trump, of course, constantly recites this poem, The Snake. And Nahusen is a snake on the pole. The Pope's auditorium is a big auditorium that gives homage to a snake. The whole Vatican appears to be in the form of a snake. So we've got, they glorify snakes, and they glorify the 88. These giants, they're giants that are running the world, and there's just this connection. I'm just seeing this connection to giants and Dan and Denmark, and now with the tribe of Dan. And Dan were meant to be the judges, right? So Dan means judge. And I've just seen all of these connections now with the tribe of Dan, potentially being Denmark, the connections to them, to the 88, to time travel, to Donald Trump and time travel. That seems to be his number. The 88 being the monarch butterfly. The monarch butterfly seems to be connected with the reborn satanic soul after they go through their MK Ultra programming. It just all seems to be about the tribe of Dan. Why did YouTube take my video down about the tribe of Dan? It's because it's the truth. There's something about Denmark, and there's something about the tribe of Dan. Dan is going to leap from Bashan. Bashan means fruitful. It's known for its fertile land. Its king was a giant, and that place, Bashan, that seems to be situated at Venus, which is the goddess of fertility. But in Joshua 9, we've got the men of Gibeon telling Joshua that they've made a long journey. They're distant people. They come from a distant land. And these bottles of wine which we filled were new, and behold, they be rent. And these our garments and our shoes are become old by reason of the long journey. And the men, right? So this is an H582 men that are also known as angels. We're talking about celestial scriptures here. And the men took of their victuals and asked not counsel at the mouth of the Lord, right? So this word victuals is the same Hebrew word as hunter. Nimrod was a mighty hunter before the Lord. This word victuals. So the men took of their hunting utensils, and they asked not counsel of the mouth of the Lord. So it seems to me that the children of Israel haven't asked the Lord about making this league with the men of Gibeon, their speech is and made as if they had been ambassadors there. They're not telling them the truth. And they took their victuals and asked not counsel of the mouth of the Lord. So Joshua made peace with them, and he made a league with them to let them live. And the princes, celestial princes of the congregation, swear unto them. Now, it came to pass after 3 days, after they'd made a league with them, that they heard that they were their neighbors, right? And that they dwelt among them. So the children of Israel have found out about the men of Gibeon that they're lying to them. And remember Gibeon? Gibeon's the place where the Lord appeared to Solomon, and Solomon went up to make the sacrifice to the Lord in 1 Kings 3. And the children of Israel journeyed, and they came to the cities on the third day. So this is after they just found out. They just found out that they were lying to them. And one of those cities were, of course, Gibeon. And the children of Israel didn't smote them because of the celestial princes, right? The princes of the congregation had sworn unto them by the Lord God of Israel. So they've sworn to the men of Gibeon by the Lord God of Israel. And all the congregation murmured against the princes because they found out that they're lying, that they're dwelling among them. And because they're dwelling among them, I'm being led to think that the Lord God was telling them that they had to smite them. Because the Lord God said you have to smite all the men of the land of Canaan, the men of Gibeon, including the men of the Hivites. But all the princes said unto the congregation, we have sworn to them by the Lord God of Israel, now therefore we may not touch them. This will we do to them, we will even let them live, lest wrath become on us because of the oath we swear unto them. And the princes said, let them live, but let them be hewers of wood and drawers of water unto all the congregation as the princes promised them. Now Joshua finds out, and Joshua asked them, wherefore have you beguiled us, saying, we are very far from you when you dwell among us? Now therefore you are cursed. So Joshua's put a curse on them now because they've lied about where they've come from, and the princes of the congregation have sworn by the Lord God of Israel that they can't touch them, and the congregation of the children of Israel, they're murmuring against the princes, and Joshua finds out and he puts a curse. He puts a curse on the men of Gibeon. So in 1 Samuel 21, we get a manifestation of that covenant being broken. Now, I can't find the scriptures, and I haven't seen them when I've read scripture about when Saul did this. But in 2 Samuel 21, these are the scriptures, right, where we read about Ishnibob, the son of the giant. These are these very same scriptures. And this word Gibeon has led me back here again, because there was a famine in the land of the days of David. 3 years, year after year, and David inquired of the Lord. And the Lord answered and said, it is for Saul and his bloody house, because he slew the Gibeonites. Now, as I say, I haven't seen these scriptures at all where it pertains to Saul doing this. David calls for the Gibeonites, and he says to them, what can I do for you so I can make an atonement that we may get the blessing back from the Lord? And the Gibeonites said to him, we won't have anything of his house whatsoever, and neither for us shalt thou kill any man in Israel. And David said, well, what is it? What do you want us to do? And they answered the king and said, the man that consumed us and that devised against us that we should be destroyed from remaining in any of the coast of Israel. Now, this I find this perplexing, and I maybe it's got something to do with giants, I'm not sure. Because they've just said that they don't want to kill any man in Israel. And now they're saying, let seven men of his sons be delivered unto us, that we will hang them up unto the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, when the Lord did choose. And the king said, I will give them. Now, this again is Hebrew word H582, men that are also known as angels. We're talking celestial scriptures again. We're talking celestial men. And they're asking that seven men of the sons of Saul be delivered to them, and they will hang them up unto the Lord in Gibeah of Saul, whom the Lord did choose. And the king said, I will give them. But here we get this again, where it just seems to be, in one scripture it says one thing, and the next scripture it seems to say something else. And David spared this fella, who was the son of Jonathan, who was the son of Saul, and David did this because of the oath that was between him and Jonathan. They had a real bond. They had a real bond. When Saul wanted to kill David, Jonathan had David's back. But in verse 8, we read of the men that are given, and this fellow is one of them. So whether there's two of them, I'm not sure. But the king took the two sons of Rizpah, the daughter of Ahiah, who she bare unto Saul, Armoni, and this fellow, and the five sons of Michal, the daughter of Saul. Now, this lady here, this is the first wife of David that Saul gave David to be his wife when David brought, it was a few hundred, I can't remember the exact number, but there was a certain number of foreskins of the Philistines. And she was the same one who despised David when David was singing in the streets when he brought up the Ark of the Covenant, whom she brought up for Adriel, the son of Basil, and he delivered them into the hands of the Gibeonites. So the Gibeonites now are getting vengeance for the blood of Saul. And hang them up in the hill before the Lord, and they fell all seven together and were put to death in the days of the harvest, in the first days, in the beginning of the barley harvest. Now this lady who had two sons slain and hung because of these things, she took sackcloth. Now get this. She spread it for her upon the rock, from the beginning of harvest until water dropped upon them out of heaven, right? So she took sackcloth and spread that sackcloth upon the rock. What rock? The rock from the beginning of harvest until water dropped upon them from out of heaven. And she suffered neither the birds of the air to rest on them by day, nor the beasts of the fields by night. Now, when David heard about her doing these things with this sackcloth, David went and took the bones. This is how he responded to this lady who had two of her sons slain, hung up, because of the covenant being broken between the Gibeonites and the children of Israel because of the house of Saul and his bloody house, right? So when David heard of her doing those things, he went and took the bones of Saul, right? This was David's reaction. He went and took the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan, his son, from the men of Jabesh-Gilead, and which had stolen them from the street of Bethshan, where the Philistines had hung them, and the Philistines had slain Saul in Gilboa. And he brought up from thence the bones of Saul and the bones of Jonathan his son, and they gathered the bones of them that were hanged. So for me now, these two things are connected. We've got the bones of Saul and Jonathan being brought up from the men of Jabesh-Gilead. This is happening as a consequence of this lady taking sackcloth and spreading that sackcloth upon the rock from the beginning of harvest until water dropped on them out of heaven. As a result of her doing that, David is taking these bones, and this lady is doing that because David took two of her sons, and the reason why David took two of her sons is because the Gibeonites have asked David that seven of Saul's sons be delivered unto them because Saul broke the covenant with the Gibeonites in Joshua 9, where they lied. The Gibeonites had lied to Joshua, and the children of Israel murmured against the princes because the princes made this covenant with the Gibeonites, and it ended up leading to Joshua cursing, ended up him cursing the Gibeonites. And in 2 Samuel 21, we read that there's a famine in the land because Saul had broken that covenant, and David wanted to make atonement for them so he could have the blessing and the inheritance of the Lord back. And those men asked for seven men of his sons to be delivered. And then this lady had two of her sons that were hung. And as a result of that, she took sackcloth and she spread that sackcloth upon the rock from the beginning of harvest until water dropped out of heaven. And then when David heard of what she was doing, David took the bones of Saul and of the bones of Saul and Jonathan, his son, buried their country of Benjamin. Benjamin, right? Here we go, Benjamin. In a sepulchre of Kish's father, and they performed all the king commanded. And after that, God was entreated for the land. after they'd done that. So God's reaction was this only after Saul reacted to this lady doing this with the sackcloth on the rock. The Lord did not entreat the land until David did this with the bones. And then God was entreated for the land. And then we get straight into the scriptures about the Philistines having war yet again with Israel. And we read about, and this was the last war. This was the last war seemingly that David fought, because Ishnebob, who was the son of the giant, it seemingly that giant being Rapha, who is in the lineage of Benjamin. He's one of the sons of Benjamin, and he's in the lineage of Saul. They thought that his new sword had slain David. So this was the last fight that David fought. But this flows straight on. This flows straight on. The Lord God was entreated for the land. And straight after that, we have another war with Ishnebob, who was the son, seemingly, of Rapha. And Rapha is living in Hades. And this was due to David taking the bones of Saul, right? And he did that because this Rizpah, the daughter of Isaiah, she took sackcloth and spread it for her upon the rock from the beginning of harvest until water dropped on them from out of heaven. And she did that because two of her sons were taken to be an atonement for the Lord, because the house of Saul had broken the covenant between the children of Israel and the Gibeonites. And that covenant was based on a lie due to the princes being beguiled. It's fascinating stuff. Now, returning to this Hebrew word for Gibeon, H1391, we see it in Joshua 10, and this is where we see a manifestation of the five kings of Canaan wanting to go to war over the league made with Gibeon. And we read about King Adonizedek, and he is the king. He's a Canaanite king of Jerusalem. Now, Jerusalem means teaching of peace, and Solomon, of course, means peace. So Solomon means peace. We've got Jerusalem means teaching of peace, and we've got Adonizedek. He's a Canaanite king, and he's king of Jerusalem, which means teaching of peace. And this word Adonizedek, it means my Lord. My Lord is righteous. So we've got a lowercase L Lord going on here. So is this the Lord Jesus Christ? Is this Jehovah? Or is this Baal? Because we know from Leviticus 18 that the land is spewing out the inhabitants, the Canaanites, because they've disobeyed every single commandment that the Lord God gave down to the children of Israel. And that's why they're getting kicked out. Now, this Adonizedek, well, he's a Canaanite king at that time where Joshua is taking over the land. My Lord is righteous. And the Chaldee lexicon, it gives us the Lord of justice. Now, as I go on and on the earth, I'm being absolutely led to think that we are living in the land of the giants, and something that's cruelly lacking from the world today is justice. So this Adonizedek, the Chaldee lexicon is giving us Lord of justice. So is this something that's gone potentially wrong? Could his name actually mean Jehovah is his Lord and Jehovah is righteous, but it's all just gone awry? Because why were they there? Why were the Canaanites in the land of Canaan, the land flowing with milk and honey, the land, the scriptures are leading me to think, in scriptures in Hebrews, that is in fact the rest of the Lord Jesus Christ. The land of Canaan is the rest of the Lord Jesus Christ, God's land. So why were they there? We know the children of Israel, they left the land of Canaan in the same state as they found it, as the Canaanites left it. So we've got Adonizedek. Well, when he started out, when they started out in the land of Canaan, was this referring to Jehovah is righteous? Because we've got Solomon. Solomon means peace. But how did Solomon end up?
Well, Solomon ended up loving many strange women, didn't he? And he went after all of these celestial gods, the goddess of fertility and Baal, and he gave his seed to Molech so they can seemingly make giants, and the Lord wasn't happy. The Lord was angry with Solomon because his heart was turned away. And what did he do? Well, I'm going to rend the kingdom from thee. But we look at Solomon's name. Well, it still means peace. So Adonizedek, I don't know. Does this mean Baal? Or does it mean the Lord Jesus Christ? I don't know. But in any case, this word Adonizedek, it looks very, very similar to Melchizedek. So Melchizedek means my king is Zedek, and he is the king of Salem and the priest of the Most High God. I'm being absolutely led to think that Melchizedek could well be the Lord Jesus Christ, because there's nobody else in Scripture that's even remotely compared to the Lord Jesus Christ. But in Hebrews 7, Melchizedek is, and they're both the priest of the Most High God. But he was king of Salem. And Salem, well, it means peace. We've got Solomon means peace, and Solomon was king in Jerusalem, which means teaching of peace. So we've got Solomon, peace, teaching of peace is where he is king. In the outline of biblical usage for Salem, most Jewish commentators affirm that this is the same as Jerusalem. So we've got Jerusalem started out meaning peace, and then it means teaching of peace. We've got Solomon, it means peace in the land that means teaching of peace. And now we've got Adonizedek, which means my Lord is righteous. He's the king of Jerusalem, which means teaching of peace. And he's a Canaanite king, of which he's being spewed out of the land of Canaan because they've disobeyed every single command. And his name also means Lord of Justice. And in Joshua 10, he goes to war over Gibeon, over the league, over the agreement that Gibeon had made with the children of Israel. And verse 2 is interesting, that they feared greatly because Gibeon was a great city, as one of the royal cities, and because it was greater than Ai and all the men. Here we go with this H582 men. It's connected. Gibeon and H582 men that are also known as angels are just connected right through this. But all the men that are also known as angels were mighty in this royal city, greater than Ai was this Gibeon, right? Now we also read it in Joshua 18. Now Joshua 18, of course, is the scriptures that I've been sharing about the lot of the tribe of the children of Benjamin, and their border went over towards Lutz, the other side of Lutz, which is Bethel. So the tribe of Benjamin got Bethel and Nether Beth Horon, right? The nether earth, hollow Hades. Is this the hollow earth that I've been talking about a couple of videos again on this video that just refuses to stop? And we read about the valley of the son of Hinnom, the valley of the giants, and the valley of Hinnom, all in the one scripture when we're talking about the lot of the children of Benjamin. And of course, the children of Benjamin have Rapha in their lineage twice, and Rapha's a giant who's dwelling in Hades. But verse 21, now the cities of the tribe of the children of Benjamin, according to their families, were Jericho. These, I'm absolutely being led to think now, are all celestial places. Because Bethel, we've got a celestial star course that goes up from Bethel to Shechem. And Bethel is the scene of Jacob's ladder, where angels were ascending and descending on that ladder. And Jacob called the name of that place Bethel because it's the house of God. And we've got angels ascending and descending there. So for me, it's pretty apparent that Bethel's a celestial place. And we get scripture that I'm going to share in just a minute, where we've got Bethel and H582 men that are also known as angels. But they got Gibeon too, right? Celestial Gibeon, being absolutely led to think that we've got celestial places going on here. But Benjamin, right? Benjamin got Gibeon, and they also got Mizpah. And Mizpah is the scene of the covenant between Jacob and Laban. Jacob begetting the 12 sons, and Laban supplying his two daughters and two concubines so those things could come to pass. So Benjamin got Gibeon. And we also read about Gibeon in 2 Samuel 12, and this is where the celestial bodies of Saul and David actually meet by a pool in Gibeon. And they sat down one side of the pool, from the other side of the pool, 12 of the host of Saul and 12 of the host of David. Joab and Abner meet, and they thrust everyone his fellow on the other side of the pool. And this went down at Gibeon. The captains of the host clashed. The captains of the celestial bodies clashed at a pool. Yeah, at a pool in Gibeon, right? And we read about it, the scriptures I'm talking about in 1 Kings 3, where Solomon offered a sacrifice on the altar at Gibeon, and the Lord appears to Solomon in Gibeon by a dream by night, right? And we also read about it in 1 Kings 9, where the Lord appears to Solomon the second time. But 1 Kings 8 is leading me to think that this took place in Jerusalem. And it came to pass, when Solomon had finished the building of the house of the Lord and the king's house and all Solomon's desire which he was pleased to do, that the Lord appeared to Solomon the second time as he had appeared unto him at Gibeon. So the Lord's appearing to Solomon this time at Jerusalem, but we're getting a roll-up of the events in 1 Kings 3 when the Lord appeared to Solomon the first time at Gibeon. That's where we read the word Gibeon there. But in verse 3, we read that the Lord is hallowing the house that Solomon is building in Jerusalem. Now, in Acts 7, a scripture that I've shared a few times on this channel, we've got verse 47, but Solomon built him a house. So just the tone of that and the language of that has led me to think that this is a bad thing. Solomon building the house is not a good thing. Stephen's telling us, but no, all these things were meant to be happening, but instead Solomon built him a house. Howbeit, the Most High dwelleth not in temples made with hands, as saith the prophet. So this is leading me to think that this is a sin of Solomon. But in 1 Kings 9, we've got the Lord hallowing the house. Now, these are the scriptures where we read about the children of Israel. They take up the tabernacle, right, of Moloch. Now, we've also got David. He found favor before God and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. So there's a point of difference here. David found favor before God and desired to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. Not to build him one, but to find him a tabernacle. But instead, Solomon built him a house. So there's a real point of difference going on here. And just this word tabernacle, because I'm being absolutely led to think that when the children of Israel made giants in the valley of the son of Hinnom, and they sent their sons and daughters and their seed through to Molech, through to Saturn, when they were worshipping the whole host of heaven and making giants, that they changed their uncorruptible image of God into an image of man. Thus they changed their similitude into an ox that eateth grass. This is what's happening. They took up the tabernacle of Moloch. They changed their uncorruptible, well, they changed their image of the uncorruptible God into the image of the beast, into the image of Saturn, into the image of Moloch. And we've got David, he's desiring to find a tabernacle for the God of Jacob. So this is telling me that there wasn't one. The God of Jacob didn't have a tabernacle, but David desired to find him one. But instead, Solomon built him a house. And this is the house we're reading in 1 Kings 9 that Solomon is building and the Lord is hallowing. But in any case, we've got the Lord appearing to Solomon the second time in Jerusalem as he appeared to him at Gibeon. And we read about Gibeon in the lineage chapters of early First Chronicles. And we read about David smoting the host of the Philistines from Gibeon and the tabernacle of the Lord in the high place that was at Gibeon, and the tabernacle of the Lord which Moses made in the wilderness, and the altar of the burnt offering that were at that season in the high place at Gibeon. Seems Gibeon is the high place. Gibeon is the high place. And Solomon and all the congregation with him went to the high place that was at Gibeon, for there was the tabernacle of the congregation of God, which Moses, the servant of the Lord, made in the wilderness. And Solomon came from his journey to the high place that was at Gibeon to Jerusalem. So he's gone from the high place to Jerusalem. Has Solomon from before the tabernacle of the congregation and reigned over Israel. And then we read it in Nehemiah 3 and 7. And next to them repaired Metallah the Gibeonite and Jadon the Marathonite, the men, the H582 men that are also known as angels and of Mitzpah. So they both went to the lot of the children of Benjamin. And we're getting the H582 men again of Gibeon and of Mitzpah, right? So we've got H582 men of Mitzpah, of Gibeon and of Mitzpah. It's both H582 men, right? And I've shared scriptures numerous times before where I'm absolutely being led to Nehemiah. I'm absolutely being led to think that Nehemiah is indeed a book set in the celestial. And we read it in Nehemiah 7, the children of Gibeon 9:90-5. Now, sometimes when I do these videos, I think to myself, what do people think? Because a lot more people are watching than what actually comment. So when I put things down, I've never heard some of the things I'm being led to think in these scriptures. I've never heard anybody talk like this. Like, so for to be learning that Moses potentially was buried in Nebo, which is Mercury, is pretty, like, it's strange. I'm sitting here all by myself, right? And it feels strange to be learning these things. And the hosts, the celestial bodies that Nebuchadnezzar sent, they appear to be from Mars. And I read it and I just think to myself, this seems quite odd and it's difficult to reconcile some days. But on it goes, because you keep pushing and I just keep getting confirmations. But I often think to myself, what do people out there actually think? So an example of this is when I say H582 men that are also known as angels, are you thinking I'm in truth here? Because remember the examples I've shared. We've got angels that are also known as men in Genesis 19. And in Joshua 6 and 2, we've got the H582 men that went to Rahab to scope out the land. They were also known as messengers. And that word messengers is the same Hebrew word as angels. And then we can relate that story back in James 2, where they're known as messengers again, and that's the same Hebrew word as angels. And we've got Gabriel in the Old Testament. He's referred to as a man, but an H376 man, and he's referred to as an angel in the New Testament. So far, till now, do you think I'm in truth? Do you think an H582 man that are also known as angels several times in the scriptures, do you think I'm in truth here? That an H582 man, every time I see it, I'm seeing a celestial body. If you are, get ready for this. If you're not, well, I don't know. But if you are, even if you're not, get ready for this. Because sometimes when I see things and the Holy Spirit shows me things in the scriptures, like to learn that Moses died in a place called Nebo, which means Mercury. It's I don't know. It's hard to it's hard to reconcile. I'm just a guy who's here all by myself, right? And it's really hard to reconcile, but you just got to keep pushing. You got to keep pushing for the truth. And just what I'm about to share, there's a couple of scriptures here that have certainly made me feel uncomfortable, and I'd love to know how this actually makes you feel. So in Nehemiah 7, we read about the men of the people of Israel was this, right? So we've got H582 men that are also known as angels. Now, bearing in mind, I've shared in scriptures previously, most notably in Nehemiah 1, where we seem to be getting a manifestation of the prophecy of Moses, where he said that the remnant of the people are going to be scattered from one end of the heaven to the other, but they're going to be collected once more into the land. And Nehemiah 1, I'm being led to think, is a manifestation of that. And then when Nehemiah is repairing all of these gates, he's repairing celestial stargates. I mean, absolutely led to think that Nehemiah is set in the heavenly realms. And whenever we see this word men, H582, for me, it's a confirmation that I'm in truth. Men that are also known as angels. Now, in Nehemiah 7, I've highlighted here in gold the word men, that is H582 angels, right? So we've got the men of. So every time we see it in gold, this is H582 men that are also known as angels, right? So I say of the men of the people of Israel were this. So all of this is talking about the H582 men, the children of. So all of these are children of the H582 men that are also known as angels. So we're talking about celestial heavenly creatures here, right? And the children of Gibeon. But get this one. This is the one that I was telling that it might make you feel a bit uncomfortable, right? The men of Bethlehem. So this is celestial H582 men that are also known as angels. So I ask you, if you've been thinking till now I'm in truth, do you still think it now? Because when I first read this, I thought, wowee, look at that. Because that's where the Lord Jesus Christ was born, wasn't he? That's where the Lord Jesus Christ was born. But we've got Nebo, haven't we? Check that out. Nebo, the men, the H582 men that are also known as angels. But we've got the other. We've got the other Nebo. Now, if you recall, Nebo means prophet, but Nebo's Mercury. Mercury, right? And it's also, the Blue Letter Bible is telling us this is the mountain where Moses died. And the scriptures in Deuteronomy 32 tells us that this is where Moses went up. He went up from the plains of Moab unto the mountain of Nebo, Mercury. And this is where the Lord showed Moses all the land of Canaan, but he couldn't go in. And we've got Blue Letter Bible telling us that this is the mountain where Moses died, and it's Latin Mercury, and the Chaldee lexicon is giving us the planet Mercury. So in Nehemiah 7, we've got the H582 men of Bethel, the scene of Jacob's ladder. And we've got angels, right? H582 men that are also known as angels ascending and descending on Jacob's ladder, and Ai. So the story in Joshua 9, the men of Gibeon had heard what the Lord had done to Jericho. We've got Jericho there, and Ai, right? The celestial men of Bethel, the celestial men of Ai, the celestial men of the other Nebo. And it is the same Hebrew word as Mercury, and that's where Moses died. It's all a little bit strange, isn't it? I told you things were getting very, very strange, and it just gets stranger and stranger, because this is a recount, this is a genealogy of all of those that went up out of the captivity of those that had been carried away
whom Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, had carried away. Now, how did Nebuchadnezzar do that? Well, we read about that in Jeremiah 39. In the ninth year of Zedekiah, king of Judah, in the 10th month came Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, and all his army, right, against Jerusalem, and they besieged it. And all the celestial princes of the king of Babylon came in and sat in the middle gate, right? Middle gate, star gate, even all of his princes. These are all princes. Now, among those princes, we've got this fella here, Nergal-Sharazar, and he means prince of fire. And yes, he's the prince of Mars, the prince whom Mars favors. And another member of Nebuchadnezzar's army was this fella, Samgar-Nebo, which means the sword of Nebo. And who's Nebo? Nebo is Latin Mercury, and Nebo is the planet Mercury. So we've got the sword of Nebo, and the Chaldee lexicon gives us the sword of Nebo, i.e. of Mercury, the sword of Mercury. And Nebo means prophet, and it's Latin Mercury, and the Chaldee lexicon gives us the planet Mercury. So then, we've got the sword of Nebo, the sword of Mercury, and we've got the prince of Mars, the prince whom Mars favors. These are they that are among all these princes of Nebuchadnezzar's army that besieged Jerusalem in the ninth year of Zedekiah, king of Judah. And when Zedekiah saw these things, all the H582 men of war, well, they fled, didn't they? This celestial battle had come to a climax, and the Israelites, the children of Judah, are being defeated by Nebuchadnezzar's army, who contained the princes of Mars and the prince of the sword of Mercury. Now, I thought I'd put in the word Nebuchadnezzar. I haven't put in the word Nebuchadnezzar yet. And what does Nebuchadnezzar mean? May Nebo protect the crown. May Mercury protect the crown. So, I thought I'd have a look, because that word crown, I thought I'd type in the word corona as to what that means in Google. And it means a part of the body resembling or likened to a crown. And number two here is an astronomical meaning. So we've got a part of the body that likened to a crown. We've got an astronomical meaning, which means the rarefied gaseous envelope of the sun and other stars. The sun's corona is normally visible only during a total solar eclipse. And we had one of those at the summer solstice last year, and we just had one in the winter solstice about 6 weeks ago. So looking at some photos, when I Google corona meaning, we've got eclipses, and we've also got these cartoon drawings for this fake coronavirus. It's very interesting, this. You see these CGI images of what they reckon the sun looks like, and we're getting CGI imagery of this coronavirus that doesn't exist. Their big gas sun doesn't exist, so it has to be a cartoon to explain it. It has to be a cartoon to explain the coronavirus. But we've got eclipses, and I'm feeling host worship again. I'm seeing host worship again, because we've got the corona is all about, it's the big thing gripping the world. It's all about an eclipse, and we just had one. We had two. We had one on the winter solstice and the summer solstice. And we look at the meanings for the word corona, and it's a part of the body resembling or likened to a crown. And remember, we've got Nebuchadnezzar means may Nebo Mercury protect the crown. And we've also got it directly connected. We've got this thing sweeping the world today, the biggest false flag in the history of the world. It's again connected to the heavenly host and directly connected to eclipses. So I thought I'd Google the word corona and the Kabbalah. And it's very, very interesting, because at the top of their Kabbalah tree, it's called Keter. Now, I don't pretend to know the first thing about this, but the top of the tree It's called Keter. And have a go at it next to it. Corona. Another name for Keter at the top of the Kabbala tree is Corona, right? And we have a look at this photo here. And we've got Keter and crown. Keter and crown. So Keter, the top of the Kabbala tree, also means crown by the looks. It also means corona. The word corona means a crown. And we've got Nebuchadnezzar, may Nebo protect the crown. And Nebo means prophet, and it's connected to Latin Mercury, and it is the planet Mercury. So let's take stock of a few things, shall we? We've got the biggest false flag ever inflicted on the world, and its name is Corona. The word Nebo in scripture means prophet, and it pertains to Latin Mercury, and the Chaldee lexicon gives us the planet Mercury, and it was worshipped in the celestial scribe by the Chaldeans, and the Chaldeans are, of course, the Babylonians. We've got Nebuchadnezzar. He was the king of Babylon who captured Jerusalem and carried away Judah captive. So he was the great Chaldean king. And Nebuchadnezzar means may Nebo protect the crown. One of his princes is called Nergal-Sharezer, and it means prince of fire, prince, a celestial prince. He was a prince in the army of Nebuchadnezzar, and the Chaldee lexicon gives us the prince of Mars, whom Mars favors. Another one of Nebuchadnezzar's princes that took Israel captive in the scriptures was Sangar-Nebo, and it means sword of Nebo, the sword of Mercury, and the Chaldee lexicon, it gives us the sword of Nebo, i.e. of Mercury, the sword of Mercury. So we've got the sword of Mercury. We've got the prince whom Mars favors. They be two princes who help King Nebuchadnezzar, which means may Nebo protect the crown. Nebo being Latin Mercury, Mercury, and he being whom the Chaldeans worshipped, the Babylonians, of whom Nebuchadnezzar was king. And the definition of the word corona gives us two results. We've got a part of the body resembling or likened to a crown. And Nebuchadnezzar means may Nebo protect the crown. And Nebo is Mercury. And we've got an astronomical definition of the word corona as well. The rarefied gaseous envelope of the sun and other stars. The sun's corona is normally visible only during a total solar eclipse. We live in a world that's run by creatures who worship the heavenly host, the Pope, at the forefront of this. And we can see with the photo that I've got up on screen now that he indeed worships the sun. And on the top of his graven image, his image of falsehood, his idol to his gods that he worships, we have the cross of Tammuz, the Templar cross, the same cross that was used by Nazi Germany. We also see that cross on the top of the crown of the New South Wales Police Service. It's also the cross that they use for the New South Wales Ambulance Service. The Queen wears that cross. The cross of Nazism, they're all Nazis, right? The Pope is chief Jesuit, and he's taken that sickening oath that I have read out on previous videos, and he is of the IHS, Isis, Horus, and Seth, ancient Egyptian worship. And we can see on the photos that I've got up on screen now, particularly this one, we've got the IHS, Jesuit, Nazi, and they worship the Black Sun. So now I'm starting to wonder whether the Nebo is indeed the Black Sun of the eclipse. We've got Donald Trump, King of Babylon. He seems to have a fetish with the golden. And you can see on these photos I've got up on screen now, is Trump addicted to golden stuff, they ask. And I can absolutely answer your question, yes. You can see on his 66th floor penthouse suite in Trump Towers that he indeed worships the sun. This entire apartment, a homage to sun worship. In December 2019, at the same time as the summer solstice here in Australia, there was a solar eclipse, and that solar eclipse resembled a corona and the black sun. In June 2020, at the time of the winter solstice here in Australia, there was another solar eclipse that again resembled a corona and the black sun. And at that time, right in the middle of that time, the whole entire world started to lose its mind over this grand Masonic spell that doesn't exist. They don't teach this in school, do they? No, they don't teach this in school. What do they teach in school? Well, at school, they teach that little Jimmy must continue to wash his hands and continue to use hand sanitizer, and that the earth's a ball, and that men crawled out of the sea, and you are a random accident, and you are to be a slave for money for your entire life. And they don't preach about this at churches, do they? No. What are they preaching at churches? The Lord Jesus Christ, he will keep you safe from this virus. Just fear not, because he's coming soon and he's going to put an end to all of these plagues on the earth. No, the Lord Jesus Christ will not keep you safe from this virus. The Lord Jesus Christ will keep you safe from these monsters who are inflicting this dystopian nightmare upon a blind, spellbound masses. Sitting grandly and proudly upon the top of their Kabbalah tree of death be the word Keter. A translation for that word Keter be corona. A second translation for that word Keter be crown. When we googled the word Keter, Keter gives us, Keter is the topmost of the Sephiroth of the tree of death in Kabbalah, since its meaning is crown, and it gives us a Hebrew word. When I google that Hebrew word, we come into the blue star, and we also come into, of course, sun worship, and we also come into crown. May Nebo protect the crown. And we've got the Queen, who's also a Templar. She's also a Nazi. She also worships the sun on her gold throne while she wears her golden crown. When we turn the Kabbalah Tree of Death over on its side, it reveals the IXXI Roman numerals for 9/11. We can see that on the flag of modern day Israel, the Star of Rephaim, the 9/11, the IXXI. The IXXI being on the Kabbalah Tree of Death. The Kabbalah Tree of Death, the top of that tree, it means Keter, which means crown, and it also means corona. In Acts 7:43, we read, "Yea, you took up the tabernacle of Molech." Now, that word tabernacle is Greek word G4633, and it means tent, tabernacle made of green boughs or skins or other materials. So I'm now being led to think that potentially this word tabernacle in the New Testament could well be a person's body. And we've got the children of Israel. Well, they took up the tabernacle of Moloch. Now, Moloch is where they sent their children through the fire in the valley of the son of Hinnom. But I'll get back to that in just a sec. And the star of your God, Rephaim. So who's Rephaim? The shrunken as lifeless. Yeah, you took up the tabernacle, the skin of Molech, and the star, the shrunken Rephaim of your God. And the Greek lexicon, it gives us Saturn, name of Saturn, but we also get an Egyptian idol, Rephaim. But we've got Rephaim being connected to Saturn. Yeah, you took up the tabernacle, the skins, the house, the body of Molech, Saturn, and the star of your God, Rephaim. Now, Rephaim means the shrunken, as lifeless, right? And remember Rapha. Rapha means tall, same as a giant. And the giants are the Rephaim. So is this the star of Rephaim? I'm being led to think it's indeed possible. The star of the giants in the sense of invigorating a giant Rapha. And Rapha gives us flaccid, feeble, weak only, i.e. means living in Hades. According to the opinions of the ancient Hebrews, void of animal life, therefore weak and languid like a sick person, but not devoid of powers of mind such as memory, which describes these creatures today running the world. But we've got flaccid, feeble and weak are these giants, Rapha, that are living in Hades. They're void of blood and animal life, therefore weak and languid like a sick person. And we've got Rephaim. It means the shrunken as lifeless. Yeah, you took up the skins of Moloch, Saturn, the god of the giants of the blue star, and the star of your god, Rephaim, which is shrunken and lifeless, and Rapha, who's a giant, the Rephaim, it's being described as flaccid, feeble, weak, void of blood and animal life, weak and languid like a sick person. Yeah, you took up the tabernacle of your Moloch and the star of your god, Rephaim. So the star of Rephaim takes us straight to the blue star, and it also takes us to the star, the cube of Saturn. And we see the cube of Saturn contained within the blue star. In Mecca, we've got all the Muslims walking around a gigantic cube, making the rings of Saturn as they do so. The 9/11 memorial, it resembles a gigantic cube that goes into the ground. In Revelation 9:11, right? And they had a king over them, which is the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name in the Hebrew tongue is Abaddon, but in the Greek tongue hath his name Apollyon. Apollyon means destroyer, the angel of the bottomless pit, the destroyer, a destroyer, i.e. Satan. So Revelation 9:11 gives us the angel of the bottomless pit, whose name is Apollyon, Satan. We've got the 9/11 memorial, which for me is resembling the opening of a bottomless pit, a great cube, of which they seem to be dancing around as they pay homage in Mecca and make the rings of Saturn. And we've got the cube of Saturn contained within that blue star. In Leviticus 18, we read in verse 20, "Moreover, thou shalt not lie carnally with thy neighbor's wife to defile thyself with her, the sons of God going into the daughters of men." And in verse 21, "And thou shalt not let any of thy seed pass through the fire to Molech, neither shall they profane the name of thy God. I am the Lord." And that word Molech means king, the god of the Ammonites and the Phoenicians, to whom some Israelites sacrificed their infants in the valley of the son of Hinnom. The valley of the son of Hinnom is where they made giants. And we read it's all about Saturn. The Chaldee lexicon gives us Saturn. So Molech is Saturn. In Jeremiah 32:35, "And they built the high places of Baal, which are in the valley of the son of Hinnom, to cause their sons and daughters to pass through the fire to Molech." So they're worshipping Jupiter, and by worshipping Jupiter, they're causing their sons and daughters to pass through the fire to Molech. Thus they take up the tabernacle, the skins of Molech, and the star of their god, making giants in the valley of the son of Hinnom with God's seed. And the star of Rephaim, of course, is the blue star, the star that they all adore, the star that they all bow down before, the star of the cube, the star of Saturn, the star of Satan. their father whose skin, whose tabernacle they have borne, their father whose star is the blue star, the star that they all worship today, the star they all serve under. It's because he is their father. It's because they are giants, and their father is, of course, Satan, as they inflict in his name this dystopian nightmare upon the population, this dystopian nightmare these host worshippers inflicting upon the population. It's called the corona, and it is a part of the body that resembles a crown, and it's also connected to the heavenly host, the sun's corona, only normal visibly during a total solar eclipse. And this whole thing came to pass, went off its head between two solar eclipses, these host worshippers, and at the top of their tree of death, Keter, whatever Keter is. Keter also means corona. It also means crown. That tree of death also taking us directly to the truth about 9/11 and the cube and Saturn worship and Satan, the star of their god. And anybody today who dare speaks the truth about the tree of death, the Kabbalah, the giants, the blue star, Saturn, Satan, are automatically labeled with the heinous label of being an anti-Semite. What is an anti-Semite? An anti-Semite is whatever they decide it is. And when you're labeled an anti-Semite, you're also likened to a Nazi, which brings into play that lie, that atrocious lie about World War II, where in fact they're the Nazis. Germany lost the war. The Nazis won the war. The giants, the Templars, those who were ruling the world in the name of evil today, in the name of the blue star, in the name of the giants, this blue star that they all love, that they all serve. We've got Donald Trump. He's glibly and very excitedly signing into law legislation that makes it an offence to be an anti-Semite, and they can just decide whatever an anti-Semite is. Being an anti-Semite is just talking the truth. And just as the Holy Spirit, the Lord Jesus Christ, is using these creatures today to pour out his wrath upon the earth among a people who know him not, back in Jeremiah 39, he was doing the same thing with Nebuchadnezzar, his servant, and with his princes, his army, using them to besiege the city of Jerusalem and taking away the people of Judah captive. And Nebuchadnezzar, of course, means may Nebo protect the crown. Nebo meaning prophet, Latin Mercury, the planet Mercury. And two of Nebuchadnezzar's host, his princes, was Sengar Nebo, the sword of Mercury, who is the sword of Nebo, the sword of Mercury, and also Nergal-Shazzar, prince of fire, who is the prince of Mars, the prince whom Mars favours. These be of the army, these princes that sat in the celestial middle gate that besieged Jerusalem and took the people of Judah away captive, including Zedekiah, the king of Judah. And when Zedekiah, the king of Judah, saw these celestial princes, all the H582 men of war then fled. This be Nebuchadnezzar's army, his host, his princes that carried away the people of Judah captive. And in Nehemiah 7, we read of the genealogy of those that went up out of the captivity, of those that had been carried away when Nebuchadnezzar, may Nebo protect the crown, king of Babylon, had carried away and came again to Jerusalem. And we get the men. We get the genealogy of these H582 men that were come up again to Jerusalem out of the captivity after Nebuchadnezzar, may Nebo protect the crown, had led them away captive. B But in Nehemiah 1 and in verse 8, we've got Nehemiah beseeching the Lord. He's praying to the Lord that the word that thou commandest thy servant know, and saying, if thy transgress, I will scatter you among the nations. And this is what Moses was talking about in Deuteronomy 30, that then the Lord thy God will turn thy captivity and have compassion on thee, and will return and gather thee from all the nations whither the Lord thy God hath scattered thee. If any of thine be driven out into the utmost parts of heaven, right? From thence will the Lord thy God gather thee, and from thence will he fetch thee. And now we've got Nehemiah in the celestial book of Nehemiah beseeching the Lord to remember that covenant. But if ye turn unto me and keep my commandments and do them, though that there were of you cast out into the utmost part of the heaven, yet I will gather you from thence, and I will bring them unto the place that I have chosen to set my name there. Now these are thy servants and thy people whom thou hast redeemed by thy great power and thy strong hand. So for me, this is fairly clear that this is a fulfillment of Moses' words in Deuteronomy 30, that the Lord is going to gather the remnant of his people from the utmost part of heaven. So for me, this is, it's quite apparent that the book of Nehemiah is taking place, it's taking place in heaven. So now when we return to Nehemiah 7 and we read about the genealogy of them that came up first, these are the children of the province that went up out of the captivity of those that had been carried away, whom Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, had carried away. And how did Nebuchadnezzar do that? Well, he did that with the sword of Mercury and with the prince of Mars, and carried away and came again to Jerusalem, to Judah, every one of his cities. So these are the men that Moses talked about that's going to be scattered into the utmost parts of heaven. And now Nehemiah is gathering them in the name of the Lord after he beseeched the Lord in Nehemiah 1. And we read about the men, the H582 men that are also known as angels. And we get the genealogy and we come down into the men of Mercury, the men of Nebo, and we've got the men of Jacob's ladder, and we've got the men, well, we've got the men of Bethlehem, haven't we? We've got the men of Bethlehem. Now, I've got some scriptures that I want to share that I've read in the New Testament, but I just want to finish off Gibeon first. I've got a couple of scriptures that I'm just starting to understand what might be happening here. But this is one of those moments where brave, yes, I do have to continue to be brave, and I will continue to be brave. But this is quite confronting to see this. The birthplace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the H582 men of Bethlehem. And I'm just being led by scripture. I think you can see with how I've just been led to think the things that I'm thinking. I've been led by scripture, and there it is. We've got the H582 men of Bethlehem. And let us not forget that we've got the H582 men also of Ai, and it was the men of Gibeon. They sought to have the covenant with Joshua due to what the Lord, what they'd heard, what the Lord had done to Ai and Jericho. And now we're reading that both of those places are of H582 men that are also known as angels in the celestial heavenly genealogy that Nehemiah is giving us, that went up from the captivity when Nebuchadnezzar with his celestial host, the sword of Mercury and the prince of Mars, took them away. We're now getting in that genealogy of the remnant of those that have been brought back from the utmost part of heaven. We're getting Ai and Jericho and the men of Gibeon, the people of Gibeon. Well, they sought this covenant with Joshua as a result to what happened at Ai and Jericho. So, and remember in 1 Kings 3, we've got Gibeon being referred to as the great high place, and that's where Solomon sacrificed and burnt incense in that high place. And this is where the Lord appeared to Solomon in Gibeon, right? And the people of Gibeon, they sought to have the covenant with Joshua because of what the Lord had done to Ai and Jericho, and now we're getting Ai and Jericho in this celestial genealogy of Nehemiah along with Bethel and Ai. Now, returning to this Hebrew word, H13914, Gibeon. Now, we read it in Isaiah 28:21, a scripture that really resonates with me because we see this word strange. You probably gather by now that this word strange has quite an impact on me in the scriptures. We are indeed strangers in a strange land, us pilgrims within the body of Christ. But we've got Solomon loved many strange women. We've got the Israelites took many strange wives. They've begotten to them strange children. And then, of course, well, then there was Joseph making himself strange. For the Lord shall rise up as in Mount Perazim, he shall be wroth as in the valley of Gibeon. The valley of Gibeon. Now remember Gibeon, it means hill city. And in 1 Kings 3, we read that Solomon, loving the Lord and walking in the statutes of David his father, only he sacrificed and burnt incense in the high places. And the king went to Gibeon, there it is there, high places, to sacrifice there, for that was the great high place. 1,000 burnt offerings did Solomon offer upon that altar. And this is where the Lord appeared to Solomon in a dream by night in 1 Kings 3, a scripture that I am endeavoring to talk more about. But led to this place, Gibeon, the Holy Spirit has led thine. And as I say, this place, Gibeon, as about as fascinating as it gets within the scriptures. But the Lord appeared to Solomon there in Gibeon, and this was the high place that Solomon sacrificed upon the altar unto the Lord. Now, this word Perazim, again, a very, very interesting word because it means breaches. I see that a lot in scripture, that word breaches. A mountain in Palestine, probably the same as Baal, right? We've got this word Baal in front of it again. The same as Baal Perazim, which was the scene of the victory of David over the Philistines, located in the valley of Rephaim. So here we go again with David fighting giants in the valley. In the valley of Rephaim, south of Jerusalem, on the road to Bethlehem. Check that out, on the road to Bethlehem. So we've got the valley of the son of Hinnom. It separates Mount Zion from the plain of Rephaim. But here we've got David fighting with giants again, this time in the valley of Rephaim. And this place, Baal Perazim, seems to be the same place. It's south of Jerusalem, but it's on the road to Bethlehem, isn't it? But Perazim means breaches, and the Strong's definition is telling us that it's a plural of H6556. And H6556, yeah, it's breach, gap, bursting forth, outburst, a broken wall, right? Outburst, figuratively, of God's wrath, but a broken wall. 1 Kings 3, and Solomon made affinity with Pharaoh, king of Egypt, and took Pharaoh's daughter and brought her into the city of David, into Zion, until he had made an end of building his own house and the wall of the Lord and the wall of Jerusalem round about. So Solomon had built the wall, and that wall had no breaches because we weren't incurring God's wrath then, because the Lord was with Solomon at this point and he's given Solomon all his gifts. He's given him all his wisdom. So there's no outburst from the Lord. The wall isn't broken down. Solomon's just finished building the wall. And we've got Nehemiah right through the celestial book of Nehemiah. What's he doing? Well, he's repairing the wall, isn't he? He's repairing the wall and all of the gates, the walls of Jerusalem and the gates of Jerusalem, because the wall had been broken down due to God's wrath. And that wall be the wall that Solomon had just finished building of Jerusalem round about. And this word breaches becomes very, very interesting indeed, because I'm just starting to see this, that each time there's a sin, there's a breach in the wall between someone and God, whether it be people as a collective, whether it be children of Israel, whether it be different collectives of people or what. But I'm just starting to see that we're getting these breaches. In Genesis 38, we read all about the scarlet thread, and these scriptures are absolutely lead me to think that Judah sinned, because he went down, in verse 1, he went down from his brethren, and in verse 2, he goes into a Canaanite woman. And just that the way that's worded, he went down from his brethren, I'm just being led to think that he did that maybe in a moral sense, but he went into a Canaanite woman, and all the scriptures are telling me that that's a big sin. Now, he promised his third-born son that he bared unto his wife. He promised her to Tamar, his daughter-in-law, the wife of his firstborn son, who the Lord slew because he was wicked. And she ended up playing the harlot, because Judah wouldn't hold up his end of the bargain. And it turns out after 3 months that she was pregnant with twins. And when the babies came out, it came to pass as he drew back his hand that behold, his brother came out, and she said, "How has this broken forth?" Right? Broken forth, this breach. So we've got a breach in the wall. Be upon thee. Therefore, his name is Phares. And we see it in Judges 21. Now, this is the aftermath of the atrocities of Judges 19, when the concubine was cut up into 12 different pieces because of what the men of Belial did. And the people repented them for Benjamin, because that the Lord had made a breach in the tribes of Israel. So I'm starting to see this now, that the Lord, this is his wrath. This is his wrath, because this word breach, it means an outburst, a broken wall. So this is God's wrath. So whenever we see God do this, and this in Genesis, this is God breaking down the wall because of sin. And then we come down into these scriptures in 2 Samuel 5:20, where we read about Baal-perazim that I'm going to share in just a sec. But that's what this word breach is starting to look like to me. We've got the wall of the Lord, and that can only be breached through sin, and that's the wall that God uses to protect people from things like the enemy and affliction. And it's God's protection. It's the barrier of God's protection. And David was displeased with the breach that the Lord made upon Uzzah, because Uzzah, he put forth his hand to the ark of God, and he took hold of it, and the oxen shook it. Now the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for this error. And there he died by the ark of God. And David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah. So it just seems that there's been a breach in the wall because of the error of Uzzah, and that error being that he put forth his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it because the oxen shook it. The anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah for this error. So there was a breach. The Lord made a breach upon Uzzah, and David was displeased because of this thing. But this scripture in 2 Samuel 5:20 is the one I want to get back to, because we see it here, Baal-perazim. But I'll get back to that one in just a sec. Now, returning to this Hebrew word, H6559 for perazim, it means breaches, and it's a mountain in Palestine. Probably the same as Baal-perazim. So the Blue Letter Bible outline of biblical usage is telling us that Baal-perazim is potentially the same place as Perazim. But here we go again with this word Baal in front of a name of a place or a person. Baal-perazim, Baal being Jupiter, a celestial body that has life. Possibly the same as Baal Perazim, which was the scene of a victory of David over the Philistines, located in the valley of where? The valley of Rephaim, the valley of the giants, south of Jerusalem. And this place, well, it's on the road to Bethlehem, isn't it? So where is the valley of Rephaim? So remember Rapha. Rapha means tall, and Rapha is a direct son of Benjamin, and he's a descendant of Saul. So we've got Rapha, tall, a son of Benjamin, and he's a descendant of Saul. He's in the lineage of Saul. Rapha, a direct son of Benjamin. And Rapha also gives us the word giant, flaccid, feeble, weak, living in Hades, according to the opinions of the ancient Hebrews, void of blood and animal life, therefore weak and languid as a sick person. So we've got these giants, Rapha, they're living in Hades and they're void of blood and animal life, but they seem to be coming across and functioning as people, presenting as people, as we see them today. Rapha, giant, who live in Hades. Now the giants are the Rephaim. And when we look at the word giant, how it's pronounced in Hebrew, well, it's pronounced as Rapha, right? So Rapha, who are the giants, who are the Rephaim. And we've got Perazim, probably the same as Baal Perazim. It's located in the valley of Rephaim. The Rephaim, well, they being the giants. Now, where do we see the Rephaim? We, of course, see the Rephaim in Joshua 15, where we read about the lot of the children of Benjamin, and the border went up. So this word giants is the same Hebrew word as Rephaim, and that is what we're reading in the outline of biblical usage that describes where Perazim is located in the valley of Rephaim. Perazim, breaches. And in Joshua 15:8, we're reading about the lot of the children of Benjamin went up by the valley of the son of Hinnom unto the south side of the Jebusite, the same as Jerusalem, and the border went up to the top of the mountain that layeth before the valley of Hinnom westward, which is at the end of the valley of giants. There it is there. So the valley of the giants, and that word giants is the same Hebrew word as Rephaim. And the valley of Rephaim, that's where this place, Perazim, is, breaches. And we're hearing that it's potentially the same place as Baal Perazim, which was the scene of a victory of David over the Philistines, located in the valley of the giants on the road to Bethlehem. Now, the word Baal Perazim means Lord of the Breaks, right? So we've got Baal Perazim means Lord, lowercase L. Now, does that mean it pertains to Baal because we've got a lowercase L, Lord of the Breaks? And we've got Perazim means breaches, breaching the wall, breaking down the wall, right? So this place, Perazim, it's in the valley of the giants, and that's where the lot of the children of Benjamin was.
There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come. You've been left behind. A man and wife are sleeping there. She hears a noise. Standing still, I wish we'd all been ready. There's no time to change your mind. The sun has come. You've been left behind. sun has come, you've been left behind.